Riders on the Storm was the second single from The Doors' sixth studio album, and it was the final release with the original lineup with Jim Morrison, before his death on July 3, 1971. It reached number 14 on the Billboard Hot 100 charts here in the United States, and number 22 on the UK singles charts. It went all the way to number 7 in the Netherlands. To this day, radio stations everywhere continue to play it, and people everywhere happily sing along, but a lot of the people who love Riders on the Storm have no idea of its meaning or dark backstory. It was inspired by the tragic case of the Mosser family murders, which occurred on December 30th of 1950. It all began when a Texas mechanic named Lee Archer was driving near Lubbock, Texas. He saw a hitchhiker on the side of the road and decided to stop and see if the young man needed a ride. William Edward Cook Jr., or Billy as he was called, robbed the Good Samaritan at gunpoint of $100 and forced the man into the trunk and drove away. Archer survived by using a tire iron to open the trunk and escape, which surely saved his life. The next family to stop and pick him up after Archer's car broke down, somewhere between Claremore and Tulsa, Oklahoma, wasn't that lucky. Carl Mosser and his wife Thelma, and their three children, Ronald, who was only 4 days away from turning 8 years old, his little brother Gary, who was 5, and their sister Pamela, who was only 2 years old, along with the family dog, were on their way to New Mexico so Carl could introduce the family to his brother. They had no way of knowing that they wasn't headed for a family reunion. They were headed on a crash course with a man from hell, Billy Cook. William Edward Cook Jr. was born in Joplin, Missouri, in 1928. He was one of 10 kids, which came from a very dark and disturbing background. His father was reportedly extremely abusive to his wife and the kids. There was said to be no food for the kids, and they often did without things the family needed, most importantly to a young kid, being love. William Sr. was not the man that most women would want to mold their sons into young men. Most normal fathers would protect their children at all costs, but when Billy's mother passed away at their home when he was just 5 years old, William Sr. did one of the most cowardly things any man could do. He packed up his children and left them in a mine and simply drove away, leaving them to fend for themselves. It wasn't long until authorities found out, and was soon sent in to rescue the kids. They were all sent to various adoptive homes, except Billy. It may have been his age, it could have been the fact that he had an odd way of looking at you. His nickname had been Billy Cockeyed Cook. It may have been his violent, bad attitude that he most likely got from his father, but one thing was unanimous. No one wanted him. He was awarded a ward of the state, and there was a woman who was receiving money for taking care of him, but whether it be by his own choice or hers, they had no relationship at all, and he rarely ever stayed at home. It wouldn't be long until he found himself in jail, which would be a very frequent thing for young Billy. Even as young as 12 years of age, Billy told the judge in one of the court hearings that he would prefer going to reform school as being in foster care. As he got older, he would get that wish granted quite often. At the age of 17, he was an inmate in the Missouri State Penitentiary. While there, instead of trying to turn his life around, he would soon be caught bashing in another inmate's head with a baseball bat. You'd think that this type of behavior would be frowned upon, and that they would have the common sense to keep him locked up, but nope. As usual, another dangerous threat to decent society, released on an unsuspecting public. Just a short 2.5 years after the baseball bat incident, they released him and said good luck. He even admitted to other inmates that his fantasy would be to hitchhike across the country while murdering anyone and everyone that he came across. His first attempt was Lee Archer. His second attempt sadly worked. As the Mosser family came upon a nice, clean-cut young man on the side of the road, Carl, being the Good Samaritan that he was, decided to pull over and offer the young man a ride. He was on the side of the road, somewhere between Claremore and Tulsa, Oklahoma. It was on December 30th of 1950. As soon as he got in and sat behind the children, he pulled a gun out and threatened the family. He forced them to drive around in random directions, often ordering the car to pull over so that he could sexually assault poor Thelma, right in front of her husband and children. As they ran low on gas and needed supplies for the trip, Billy held a gun on Carl and ordered him into the service station in Wichita Falls, Texas, but tried to keep the gun hidden from sight so they could get out undetected. Carl, however, saw this as his one shot to get help. So he grabbed Billy's arm and tried to wrestle the gun from him and started yelling for the service station attendant to get help and explained that this man had been holding his family at gunpoint and was going to kill them. The service station attendant was either too scared to do anything, or he didn't believe him, because he grabbed his own shotgun and ordered both men to leave the store. He literally handed the Mosser family's lives to Billy Cook that night. Billy ordered Carl back in the car and ordered him to continue driving through the night. As night turned into early morning, Billy became very drowsy and would drift in and out of sleep. As he slept, the Mosser family car had sped up and was coming upon an on-duty police officer. Carl had planned to drive up beside the officer and get his attention, which would have saved their lives most likely, but sadly, Billy woke up and saw what was going on. He ordered Carl to back away from the police car, or he would shoot his children in the head. Carl was either scared into shock, or he was trying to keep their one chance at staying alive intact, and before Billy warned him again, he shot one of the children point blank in the back of the head. He ordered the family to pull over on the side of the road and continued killing each of them, even the dog. Cook headed back to California after abandoning the Mosser car in Oklahoma. The vehicle was discovered full of bullet holes and covered in blood. The receipt for Cook's gun was found in the car. The family was nowhere to be found. Deputy Sheriff Homer Waldrop of Blythe, California knew Billy and his history very well. As soon as he knew he was back in town, he became suspicious of the way he was acting, so he went to the hotel where Billy and another friend had been living. He wanted to question the friend to see what Billy had been up to. Instead, Billy himself was there and he jumped out and pulled a gun on the sheriff. As with the Mosser family, he held the officer at gunpoint and forced him to drive around, while bragging about how he had killed the entire Mosser family and dumped their bodies in a mine. He seemed quite proud of his dark deeds. The sheriff, however, was absolutely horrified. Soon, Cook became bored with the sheriff and told him that he was going to pull over and shoot him in the head. I can't even imagine how terrified the officer had to be. He forced him to lie down on the ground, face down, but instead of shooting the officer, he let him live and jumped back in the patrol car and took off. He knew he would be caught in no time driving a police car, so he flagged down another driver who had stopped to help, a man by the name of Robert Dewey. As Cook forced Dewey to drive, they wrestled for the gun and Dewey was shot and killed. Cook left Dewey's body in the police cruiser that he abandoned and took off in Dewey's car. Billy Cook then drove Dewey's car across the border to Mexico, where you'd think that he would have the common sense to stay, but common sense isn't usually very common in men like Billy. He returned to the United States and soon kidnapped two more men at gunpoint: James Burke and Forrest Dameron. He forced them to drive across the Mexican border to Santa Rosalia, where he was recognized by the Santa Rosalia police chief, Luis Parra. Luis simply walked up to Cook and grabbed the .32 caliber revolver from his belt and arrested him on the spot. Billy Cook's killing spree was finally over. Cook was returned to Oklahoma City to answer for the Mosser family murders. He was sentenced to 300 years in prison. In 1951, a California jury sentenced him to death for killing of Robert Dewey. On December 12, 1952, Cook was executed in the gas chamber at San Quentin Prison. "I hate everybody's guts, and everybody hates mine," he said at the time of his execution. He was put to death at the ripe old age of 24. Kind of ironic, isn't it? He murdered a family of five, including three small children, and just got prison time in one state, while killing just one man in the next and receiving the ultimate punishment. I'd love to hear everyone's thoughts on this one. I'd also love to know if you think any differently now of the song, Riders on the Storm. I can't listen to it now without seeing these horrific deeds in my head. As always, we appreciate every like, share and subscribe. Check out our merchandise store as well as website for all kinds of cool offers. If there's any story you'd like to hear, let us know. We cover true crime, old or current, as well as ghostly stories, UFO encounters, things that go bump in the night, and anything else that's creepy, dark, or interesting. Thank you all very much, and we'll see you next time.